Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Fossil Capital, The Rise of Steam Power and the Roots of Global Warming by Andreas Malm. Narrated by Liam Gerrard. Publisher's note. In this audio edition, you will hear references to figures present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Chapter 1. In the Heat of the Past. Towards a History of the Fossil Economy. In those spacious halls, the benignant power of steam summons around him his myriads of willing menials and assigns to each the regulated task, substituting for painful muscular effort on their part the energies of his own gigantic arm, and demanding in turn only attention and dexterity to correct such little aberrations as casually occur in workmanship. Andrew Ure, The Philosophy of Manufacturers, 1835. The chemical changes which thus take place are constantly increasing the atmosphere by large quantities of carbonic acid, that is, carbon dioxide, and other gases noxious to animal life. The means by which nature decomposes these elements, or reconverts them into a solid form, are not sufficiently known. Charles Babbage, On the Economy of Machinery and Manufacturers, 1835. Besides, what has your steam engine and your cast iron done for us? Not to mention the gas, whose frequent explosions threaten one day to blow up Babylon itself. Anonymous worker in The Metropolitan, Imprisonment for Debt, May 1834. Global warming is the unintended byproduct par excellence. A cotton manufacturer of early 19th century Lancashire, who decided to forego his old water wheel and invest in a steam engine, erect a chimney and order coal from a nearby pit, did not, in all likelihood, entertain the possibility that this act could have any kind of relationship to the extent of Arctic sea ice, the salinity of Nile Delta soil, the altitude of the Maldives, the frequency of droughts on the Horn of Africa, the diversity of amphibian species in Central American rainforests, the availability of water in Asian rivers, or, for that matter, the risk of flooding along the Thames and the English coastline. Nonetheless, sporadic forebodings appear in the literature of the time. One notable flash of apprehension about the atmospheric consequences of employing steam power in factories can be found in the first chapter of Charles Babbage's classic treatise On the Economy of Machinery and Manufacturers. Babbage is credited with being the father of the modern computer. His book is considered the first to introduce the factory into the realm of economic analysis. He made his fleeting remark some 3 decades before John Tyndall explained the greenhouse effect, and some 6 decades before Svante Arrhenius first calculated the rise in surface temperature on the Earth following an increase in emissions of carbon dioxide, called carbonic acid by Arrhenius as well. But the environmentally concerned inquiry of the pioneer economist was instantly truncated due to sheer lack of knowledge. Babbage was verging on uncharted territory. Instead, his book continued as one long encomium to the wonders of machinery. First and foremost, the check which it affords against the inattention, the idleness, or the dishonesty of human agents. In that turn of phrase, Babbage articulated a leitmotif of bourgeois thinking corresponding to the operating procedures of manufacturers who fought the annoying idiosyncrasies of human workers precisely by installing ever more machinery impelled by ever more powerful steam engines, unsuspecting of any particular noxious effects. Those on the receiving end of that machinery had more reason to be afraid. Now they know what they do. By now, the science of the byproduct is perfectly clear. It has been so in its basic outlines for roughly as long as capitalism has been free of really existing adversaries. In 1990, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, IPCC, submitted its first report on the likely fate of a warming world. The facts and projections served as the basis for the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change, UNFCCC, signed at the Earth Summit in Rio de Janeiro in 1992, and ratified by all UN members, who pledged to prevent dangerous anthropogenic interference with the climate system. By cutting their emissions of greenhouse gases, chief among them carbon dioxide. Yet in 2012, global CO2 emissions were 58% higher than in 1990. By that time, the IPCC was preparing its fifth report, each edition more certain of the disastrous implications of business as usual than the previous one, as a permanent hailstorm of scientific warnings rained down on humanity. A random pick from some leading journals in the years 2012-14, hurricanes in all ocean basins are becoming markedly stronger due to higher temperatures. North American butterfly populations have embarked on a perilous journey north to escape the rising heat. Arctic ecosystems are fast approaching a whole range of tipping points, the threshold beyond which the Greenland ice sheet will plunge into irreversible melting, raising sea levels by 6 metres. Is a warming of 1.6 degrees Celsius rather than 3.1 degrees Celsius as previously thought. The retreat of glaciers in Tian Shan is accelerating, primarily in areas where they are most essential for irrigation in summertime, some rivers having already shrunk to tiny rivulets. Since the mid-1980s, the vegetation of Congolese rainforests has browned, dried out and declined. Climate change could wipe out the equivalent of the entire present yield of maize, soybeans, wheat and rice in key producing regions by the end of the century. The old target of keeping global warming below 2 degrees, widely regarded as obsolete due to the already painful impacts of a mere 0.85 degrees, is rapidly slipping out of reach. And on it goes. Everybody knows it. Whether one chooses to ignore, suppress, deny or agonise over the knowledge of what is happening, it is there, in the air, heavier by the year. And yet the descendants of the Lancashire manufacturers, whose dominion now span the globe, are taking decisions on a daily basis to invest in new oil wells, new coal-fired power plants, new airports, new highways, new liquefied natural gas facilities, new machines to replace human workers so that emissions are not only continuing to grow, but doing so at a higher speed. In the 1990s, the annual increase in global CO2 emissions stood at an average 1%. Since 2000, the figure has been 3.1%, a tripled growth rate, exceeding the worst-case scenarios developed by the IPCC and expressing a trend that still does not show any sign of reversal. The more knowledge there is of the consequences, the more fossil fuels are burnt. How did we get caught up in this mess? History under a heavy sky. In the first pages of his acclaimed textbook, Political Ecology, Paul Robbins travels to Yellowstone National Park to observe what lies behind its veneer of pristine wilderness. To an untrained eye, the iconic features of the landscape might appear perfectly natural. In fact, they are intensely produced. The native hunters that once roamed the land have been removed by fiat. Wolves were first extinguished and then reintroduced. Managing authorities have alternated between culling elk populations and allowing them to explode, suppressing fires and permitting them to rip through the valleys and leave their mark on the biota. At every step, walking through forests and along rivers, sighting some animals and not others, Robbins discerns the effects of power struggles that have raged over the park, between the state and the native population, between hunters and environmentalists, hoteliers and scientists. Out of the raw material at hand, political actors have created the ecology of Yellowstone, often with chains of unintended consequences. A traveller along the frontiers of climate change today, not to speak of tomorrow, might encounter a landscape even more thoroughly shaped by humans with power. Weather conditions, types of vegetation, entire biomes, even the sea itself might have fallen into place as a fallout of the combustion of fossil fuels. But where Robbins is able to trace a certain property of the Yellowstone landscape to a specific decision made in the past, the absence of natives to their historical removal, the climate change traveller can, by the nature of things, see no such straight lines. a submerged islet, has borne the full weight of a history lacking differentiation. No single decision, no emission of one ton of greenhouse gases, can be connected to this particular scene. The burning of this barrel of Texas oil cannot be pinned down as the cause of this Levantine drought. Every impact of anthropogenic climate change carries the imprint of every human act with a radiative forcing, such that they are infinitesimal representatives of two moving aggregates, the aftermath and the source, intimately coupled yet strangely disconnected from each other. Eyes gazing on abruptly transformed ecosystems are forced to turn back towards human society, or to understand what has happened. But where should they look? Only a totality can be the object of interest. We shall call it, provisionally, the fossil economy. Seen from another angle, global warming is a sun mercilessly projecting a new light onto history. Only now is it becoming apparent what it really meant to burn coal and send forth smoke from a stack in Manchester in 1842. When natural scientists discovered global warming, they passed on a discovery to historians yet to be made on anything like a comprehensive scale. These things were there for two centuries, invisible up to the present. Now is the time to turn over 1,000 stones, to unearth the climactic implications of innumerable actions, not merely because the smallest puff of smoke in Manchester in 1842 released a quantity of CO2, which then lingered in the atmosphere, playing a microscopic part in the creation of the current climate, but also, and more importantly, because the fossil economy was established, entrenched, and expanded in the process. It is as though a novel dimension has been suddenly revealed in modern history. Just think, in this light, of the building of the railway networks, the construction of the Suez Canal, the introduction of electricity, the discovery of oil in the Middle East, the rise of suburbia, the CIA coup against Mohammad Mossadegh, the opening of the Chinese economy by Deng Xiaoping, the American invasion of Iraq. As a series of moments in the historical totality of the fossil economy, deepening its channels, adding ever greater volumes of fossil fuels to the fire, these events are retroactively suffused with a new significance, calling for a return to history, eyes wide open. Would such a history be environmental? Most traditional concerns in the field, say deforestation, air pollution, species extinction through hunting or overfishing, pathogen movement through trade or invasion, exhibit some kind of historical immediacy. The cutting down of a forest is deforestation. In his The Chimney of the World, A History of Smoke Pollution in Victorian and Edwardian Manchester, Stephen Mosley puts out that smoke could be easily perceived by 4 of the 5 senses. One could see it, smell it, touch it, and it could be tasted. He is obviously engaging in an environmental history, writing of how the natural world in and around Manchester was transformed through the explosive spread of dense black clouds in the 19th century. But the burning of coal in that town also had another ramification, which did not, as it were, touch down in the environment until much later, after a whole series of biogeochemical and social mediations. The writing of that history should be a central task, and yet it is bound to have an odd quality of detachment from environmental repercussions. Insofar as we are interested in the fossil economy as the instigator of climate change, its ecological dimensions must be placed within the brackets of posterity in a way that hardly applies to any other problem of environmental history. Even nuclear waste, whose fallout is comparable to global warming in duration, is immediately constituted and handled as such. Anthropogenic climate change, this is part of its very definition, has its roots outside the realm of temperature and precipitation, turtles and polar bears, inside a sphere of human praxis that could be summed up in one word, as labour. At the intersection of climate and history, most scholarly traffic has so far moved in the other direction. The search for meteorological causes of past events is currently undergoing a spectacular renaissance. Climactic fluctuations are said to have had a finger or two in everything from the collapse of the Mayan civilization and the conquests of the Vikings to the witch hunts and the French Revolution. Promising analogues for the future, this endeavour uses data on temperature and precipitation to explain crisis, war, persecution, upheaval and other social affairs. Explanations well worth pursuing for their own sake, albeit with certain well-known pitfalls, but not particularly appropriate in constructing the historiography of global warming. Here, it is a matter of searching not for climate in history, but for history in climate. Data on factory legislation or free trade policy should be brought to bear on rainfall and ice, rather than the other way around. In a warming world, causation runs, at least initially, from company to cloud. It is that leap across ontological divides that calls for reconstruction. The Revenge of Time. Over the past decades, critical theory has moved towards space, away from time, as the long-favoured dimension, the classical vessel of structure, causation, rupture, possibility. Within historical materialism, this spatial turn has generated the meteoric rise of critical geography, now equaling or surpassing the time-honoured discipline of history in innovativeness and influence. The star of David Harvey shines brighter than that of any Marxist historian. Another adept in the field, Neil Smith, hymns the victory of space over time in Uneven Development, Nature, Capital and the Production of Space, quoting approvingly such one-liners as, "We are in the epoch of simultaneity. The present epoch will perhaps be above all the epoch of space. Prophecy now involves a geographical rather than historical projection," whatever that could possibly mean. Even endorsing Francis Fukuyama's infamous thesis of the end of history by asserting that, indeed, historical time would seem to be over. Global warming should put such fantasies to rest. Floors below the desk where these words are written, people travel to work in cars, go on visits and vacations in cars, drive their shopping lists and shopping bags back and forth in cars. Nowhere is simultaneity to be seen. Cars, to begin with, run on fossil energy, a legacy of photosynthesis originating hundreds of millions of years ago. The vehicles were not invented just now. They spread in the 20th century. The choice to travel in them, rather than in trams or buses or on bicycles, is conditioned by a vast infrastructure of oil terminals, petroleum refineries, asphalt plants, road networks, gasoline stations, not to speak of the film industry, the lobbying groups, the billboards, which did not fall from the sky in this moment, but was built up over time, eventually amassing such weight and inertia that other modes of transportation are now excluded, or at least prevented from rising to predominance. This is what some refer to as carbon lock-in, a cementation of fossil fuel-based technologies, deflecting alternatives and obstructing policies of climate change mitigation, a poisoned fruit of history. Furthermore, there is reason to suspect that the heat wave and drought plaguing this part of the country, sending residents to seek relief by leaving the town in cars, has some connection to climate change. Signs of a future to come, a state of weather in the making, and if that suspicion is at least partly correct, not even the weather belongs fully to the moment. It is a product of past emissions. The emissions produced by the cars running to and fro, meanwhile, will have their greatest impact on generations not yet born. They are so many invisible missiles aimed at the future. Wherever we look at our changing climate, we find ourselves in the grip of the flow of time. The transfer of carbon from geological reserves to fireplaces, and thence to the atmosphere, into the running carbon cycle from which it was locked away for ages and eras, sets the process in motion. But the effects are always delayed. It takes time before a certain quantity of CO2 emissions is released as a corresponding amount of warming, and before that warming takes its full toll on the ecosystems. For every emission added to past output, the atmospheric concentration of the gas increases, its effect further augmented in accordance with the fundamental tenet of climate science: emissions are cumulative. The release of 1 ton of CO2 would not be so dangerous were it not for the billions of tons already out there. It is the total accumulation that pushes temperatures upwards, and the more that has been emitted, the smaller the prospect of limiting the ongoing rise. If humanity wishes to avoid a certain temperature threshold, say 2 degrees Celsius, only a certain amount can be emitted, roughly 1 trillion tons, and for every year emissions continue, not to speak of increase, that budget is progressively squandered. If 1 ton is emitted in this second, a fourth of it will stay in the atmosphere for hundreds of thousands of years. If we wait some time longer, and then demolish the fossil economy in one giant blow, it would still cast a shadow far into the future. Emissions slashed to zero, the sea might continue to rise for many hundreds of years, the waters slowly expanding as the heat makes its way deeper and deeper into the oceans. A rising and warming sea could then unhinge ice sheets, thaw permafrost, destabilize methane hydrates, or trigger other feedback mechanisms centuries after a complete cessation of emissions. Once a certain historical level has been reached, in keeping with the long memory of the climate system. At its core, then, climate change is a messy mix-up of timescales. The fundamental variables of the process, the nature of fossil fuels, the economies based on them, the societies addicted to them, the consequences of their combustion, operate over seemingly unrelated temporal spans, all refracted in the moving, elusive present of a warming world. In an elevated sense of the term, every conjecture now combines relics and arrows, loops and postponements that stretch from the deepest past to the most distant future, via a now that is non-contemporaneous with itself. Ours is, if anything, an epoch of diachronicity. The temporal aspect is particularly striking, writes philosopher Stephen Gardner, who has done perhaps more than anyone to foreground it in A Perfect Moral Storm, The Ethical Tragedy of Climate Change. It catches us in a bind. Given that global warming is seriously backloaded, every moment experiencing a higher temperature posted from the past, and substantially deferred, the cumulative effects of current emissions arriving in the future, a warped ethical structure arises. The person who harms others by burning fossil fuels cannot even potentially encounter his victims, because they do not yet exist. Living in the here and now, he reaps all the benefits from the combustion but few of the injuries, which will be suffered by people who are not around and cannot voice their opposition. Each generation, reasons Gardner, thus faces a perverse incentive to pass the buck to the next, which also profits from its own fossil fuel combustion while dodging the pain from it, and so on in a vicious cycle of infliction of harm. Rob Nixon would call it slow violence. In Slow Violence and the Environmentalism of the Poor, he grapples with a problem closely related to Gardner's, though coming from the angle of literary theory. Violence is customarily conceived as an event or action that is immediate in time, explosive and spectacular in space, and as erupting into instant sensational visibility, he writes, but there is also a different kind of violence, not rapid, but slow motion, not instantaneous, but incremental, not body to body, but playing out over vast stretches of time through the medium of ecosystems, and therefore far more difficult to capture between book covers or on screen than the bullets of a sniper. When a company dumps a toxic chemical substance in a poor country, the violence is only being felt gradually, decoupled from its original causes by the workings of time. Never contemporaneous with the act itself, Nixon places fossil fuel combustion in the same category. He then asks, how can slow violence be represented in narratives that catch our attention? What are its equivalents in the crime novel, the war epic, the action movie? Symptomatically, he finds and reads stories and essays on the slow violence of the Bhopal disaster, oil exploitation in the Arabian Gulf and the Niger Delta, mega dams in India, natural parks in South Africa, depleted uranium in Iraq, but none on climate change as such. Here, the capacity to imagine violence seems to have reached its limit. There is more to these temporalities than dilemmas of ethics and representation, however. The longer business as usual persists, the harder it becomes to break out of it. Every round of new pipelines and tankers and deep water drilling rigs encumbers the next decades with an even more ponderous mass of infrastructure into which carbon has been locked. The ruts of path dependency deepen. Every generation, presiding over growing emissions, adds more than the former to the accumulation of CO2 in the atmosphere. For every year global warming continues and temperatures soar higher, living conditions on Earth will be determined more intensely by the emissions of yore, so that the grip of yesteryear on today intensifies, or, put differently, the causal power of the past inexorably rises, all the way up to the point when it is indeed too late. The significance of that terrible destiny, so often warned of in climate change discourse, is the final falling in of history on the present. History does not usually work in this way. The echo of Caesar's march across Rubicon, the fall of the Ming Dynasty, the formation of the Sokoto Caliphate, or the storming of the Bastille can be expected to fade away as time goes by, or at least there is no inbuilt mechanism to amplify it. But in times of global warming, iron laws of economics and geophysics boost the past from behind, so to speak. The tradition of the dead generations weighs like a nightmare on the minds of the living, Karl Marx famously wrote in the 18th Brumaire of Louis Bonaparte. In a warming world, it weighs down heavier and heavier on the bodies of the living and their surroundings, in a relentless consolidation of the tyranny of the past. This will certainly be more than a gradual progression. Extreme weather events convert the attrition of slow violence into photogenic spectacle. Think of a flooding in Pakistan or a wildfire in Colorado. The snap disasters of abrupt climate change, the fatal crossings of tipping points in the Earth system, would mark the sudden eruption of the mounting history of the fossil economy onto the stage of the present. Indeed, as unseasonable weather is becoming the new norm, this is already happening. When Julius, the protagonist in Teju Cole's novel Open City, roams the streets of New York in the middle of November without yet having had the occasion to wear his coat, he cannot help but suspect, with a sense of sudden discomfort, an effect of global warming. Contrary to popular misconceptions in the media, and to Julius's own scepticism, it is now perfectly possible to attribute a particular heatwave or other anomaly to the underlying rise in average temperatures, in whose absence such events would have been utterly improbable. The thermometer can be legitimately suspected as a barometer of the rolling invasion of the past into the present. There follows, from all of this, a very peculiar temporality of climate change politics. Few, if any, other issues have such heightening urgency built into them by dint of sheer physical laws. The point of too late is coming closer by the day, and the closer it comes, the more swift and comprehensive the emissions cuts must be. The tradition of the dead is breathing down the necks of the living, leaving them with two choices. Smash their way out of business as usual, and the heavier the breath, the more extreme the measures must be, or succumb to an accumulated, unbearable destiny. As of this writing, both scenarios remain possible. The famed window of opportunity for abolishing the fossil economy and stabilizing climate within tolerable bounds, even returning it to safer conditions, is still there. If emissions were reduced to zero, the rise in temperatures would soon taper off. Such an enterprise would have to stage a full-scale onslaught on the structural nightmares bequeathed by the past. It would be a revolution against history, an exodus, an escape from it in the last moment, and it would have to know what it has to struggle against. None of this is meant to deny that space is a crucial dimension or that geographers have enriched critical theory with an abundance of insights. We shall deal with the former and draw on the latter quite extensively in what follows. But now is a singularly bad time for declaring the demise of time. The spaces of climate change are relevant only insofar as they are folded within the process. The change, the warming. As the word indicates, this tempest is eminently temporal. Searching for the origins of the fossil economy. What do we mean by the fossil economy? A simple definition would be an economy of self-sustaining growth predicated on the growing consumption of fossil fuels, and therefore generating a sustained growth in emissions of carbon dioxide. Roughly synonymous with business as usual in the lexicon of climate politics, this, we submit, is the main driver of global warming. It first appeared during the Industrial Revolution, whose great historical feat was to inaugurate an era of self-sustaining growth, meaning a process of growth that was not episodic, evanescent, broken off after a brief efflorescence, but persistent and unremitting, a secular progression propelled by its own inner forces. In biophysical or thermodynamic terms, no growth can, of course, feed upon itself. One of the key lessons of ecological economics is that it always relies on the withdrawal and dissipation of natural resources. But, through mechanisms to be specified later, the fire of modern growth reproduces an economic gas that necessarily ignites as more growth, the result of the process spurring it to advance further, the loop reinforced anew on a grander scale. And in this, and only this sense, is it self-sustaining. The fossil economy was born when that fire began to be fed by the material fuel of fossil energy. Now we immediately see that the fossil economy, under this definition, cannot account for all human influence on the climate. Fossil fuel combustion is only one cause of global warming, just as the sun is only one of the bodies in the solar system, and the American president only one in a larger team. The others, puny by comparison, revolve around it. Land use change, read deforestation, accounts for a fourth of all CO2 released since 1870, but its share is secularly diminishing, now standing at around 8% of current emissions, fossil fuels taking up virtually all the rest. Then there are the other greenhouse gases, methane, nitrous dioxide, ozone, sulfur hexafluoride, whose social histories would have to be recounted for a full picture to emerge. But it is safe to say that the burning of fossil fuels is the hard core of the problem, quantitatively dominant and qualitatively determinant. It deserves special focus. If emissions of carbon dioxide ceased to increase and stayed constant, atmospheric concentrations would still continue to climb. Absolute volumes of CO2 are, in the end, what matters for climate. Then why include their growth in the definition of the fossil economy? Because it is the union of economic expansion and fossil energy consumption that has pushed emissions up to the present, utterly unsustainable, and still rising, levels. This is the really existing process, the alloy that has brought us to this warmer place. Three major deviations from the norm are possible. An economy that grows while its emissions flatten out, even if on a high level, can be classified as a decoupled fossil economy. It might still be overwhelmingly based on fossil fuels, but only one of the two components remains in motion. One with no trend in either respect may be termed a steady-state fossil economy, while one with continuously diminishing emissions due to spontaneous breakdown, deliberately orchestrated policies or some other factor, is a fossil economy in decline. To the extent that these variants have existed at all, they have been exceptions proving the rule, or aberrations from business as usual, pretensions to decoupling gainsaid by rising emissions embodied in imports, steady state situations, a transient feature of crisis, such as in 2009. Decline, notably in Eastern Europe in the 1990s, followed by rebound. None undermines our definition of the object of historical inquiry. The fossil economy has the character of a totality, a distinguishable entity, a socio-ecological structure in which a certain economic process and a certain form of energy are welded together. It has some identity over time. Contrary to the axioms of methodological individualism, the embryonic individual is suspended in its fluid. A person born today in Britain or China enters a pre-existing fossil economy, which has long since assumed an existence of its own and confronts the newborn as an objective fact. It possesses real causal powers, most notably the power to alter the climactic conditions on planet Earth. But this only is a function of its power to direct human conduct. A factory manager will be pressured to obtain energy by plugging into the current from the nearest coal-fired power plant, rather than building her own water wheel. The company owner will send her commodities to the world market on cargo vessels, rather than sailing ships. A cashier may have little choice but to commute to the supermarket in a car. She certainly won't ride a horse, and if she wants to go on vacation, she will encounter intense advertising for flying as a transportation option. Moreover, none of these emitting actions would be possible without integration into the fossil economy. Alone on an island, or living in a country untouched by this economy, an individual could complete none of them. As such, then, the fossil economy is an altogether historical substance. It must have undergone its own birth once upon a time. The causal powers it now exerts are emergent properties. They were not always there. Agents must have created it through events amounting to a moment of construction, much as, once erected, a building's structure is now an enduring feature of the world, entrenched in the environment. It conditions the movement of the people inside. Eventually, it appears indistinguishable from life itself, business as usual. But the fossil economy was once constructed and has since been reproduced and enlarged, and anything built over time can potentially be torn down or escaped. So how did it all begin? Where would the search for a moment of construction lead us? While several countries could lay claim to being the cradle of modernity, capitalism, enlightenment, or liberal democracy, the fossil economy has one incontestable birthplace. Britain accounted for 80% of global emissions of CO2 from fossil fuel combustion in 1825, and 62% in 1850. There is a margin of error in these figures, but they give us an idea of the proportions and trends, suggesting that Britain lost some of its paramountcy as the consumption of fossil fuels spread to other countries, but continued to generate more than half the world's emissions far into the 19th century. The origins of our predicament must be located on British soil. Consequently, there has been a minor flurry of interest in revisiting the British Industrial Revolution for clues as to how all of this happened, and, not the least, what to do now. An energy transition, most simply defined as a switch from an economic system dependent on one or a series of energy sources and technologies to another, occurred at that time. We are heading towards another transition. Thus, the argument goes, we need to learn from the past to proceed as best we can now. If we think of the fossil economy not as a static building, but rather as a train, put at a point in the past on the current perilous track, we require knowledge of the switching mechanism to enter a safer course. The British Industrial Revolution here assumes the status of a unique archive of lessons. What do they say? First, the transition was slow. Second, it was driven by prices. Third, it required new technology. Add human capital, scientific discovery, cooperation, and narrow self-interest in equal measures, and, concludes economic historian Robert Allen, a future transition to sustainable energy will also share these characteristics. Most importantly, people respond to price incentives. One lesson often taken away from the switch to fossil fuels is precisely that it was protracted, passing through several phases of stumbling experimentation, the agents slowly learning to master the novel form of energy, and hence the shift away from them should follow the same pace and refrain from premature scaling up of technologies and industries. A transition must be given time. Even more critical, as we shall hear, is the presumed lesson of prices. Fossil fuels won the original race because they were cheapest, and the same advantage will now have to be secured for renewable alternatives if they shall have a chance. Moreover, if the British Industrial Revolution stands as a model for the Second Industrial Revolution, or the green, or the low carbon, or the sustainable one, yet another lesson seems unavoidable. the profit motive of small and medium-sized enterprises, rather than community action, might drive innovation. The fact that the instigators of the switches back then were competitive capitalists and became wealthy as a result counsels us from assuming that only communal initiatives can drive radical change. Capitalists slowly unrolling technologies with lower prices. This is the manual to follow. But any straight parallelism between the entry into and the exit from the fossil economy is spurious. It comes close to the fallacy of presupposing that the present is essentially the same as the past, allowing for an immediate transfer of precepts, such as when generals have drawn up their strategies from the lessons of ancient battles and suffered grievous defeat, forgetting the Heraclitean rule that you cannot step into the same river twice. As several scholars have pointed out, the transition now impending, if indeed it is, would be motivated by the urgent need to stave off or at least minimise catastrophic climate change, a danger humanity has never before confronted, and one which certainly did not figure in the calculations of early British industrialists. The most highly prized quality of renewable energy would be low or zero emissions of carbon dioxide, a public good, not a private benefit. Time is already characterised by being short. For these and other reasons, the next transition cannot share the canonical features of the British Industrial Revolution. Above all, this time, it would have to be collectively planned. But it would face impediments. Measures necessary for an enforced, rapid, politically driven phase-out of fossil fuels may, as IPCC tersely notes in a summary for policymakers from 2007, be difficult to implement, due to what the panel labels a key constraint, namely resistance by vested interests. In these few words, a planet of antagonism briefly comes into view. So fossil fuels have to be discarded for human civilization to endure and thrive. But there are vested interests standing in the way. What are they? Here might lie a better reason to revisit the Industrial Revolution. If the fossil economy is a train that never stops but always accelerates, even when approaching the precipice, the task is to pull the brakes, or maybe jump off in time. And if there is a driver who seeks to keep this from happening, she has probably been seated in the locomotive for some time. We need to know who she is and how she works. Or perhaps it is an automatic engine, a driverless construction, but the need would be the same. The interests that once put the train in motion may still be driving it. The previous transition, then, would be not so much a template for the next as a key to understanding and removing the impediments. We cannot know this for sure. It is a mere suspicion. It is, of course, conceivable that the initial reasons for taking up fossil fuels are entirely unrelated to the interest in clinging to them now, which might have taken over at some point along the journey. But if we want to know more about the propulsive forces of the fossil economy, its laws of motion and the interests invested in it, the beginning seems a good place to start. Whether we frame this as a search for parallels or for enemies, the underlying assumption is that meaningful action can be undertaken. It is not yet too late. But what if it is? If there's no action before 2012, that's too late, declared Rajendra Pachauri, chair of the IPCC, in 2007. What we do in the next 2 or 3 years will determine our future. This is the defining moment. What if that were no mere rhetoric, but an accurate forecast soon to be fully vindicated? Then, would there be any point in delving into the annals of the fossil economy? If any historical matters exist that would be of interest under sea levels 2 metres higher, this might be one of the few. Or with Gardner, there is a task of bearing witness to serious wrongs, even when there is little hope of change. The militant reason for studying the history of the fossil economy has a meditative backup. Both boil down to, in the simplest possible terms, that one burning question. How did we end up in this predicament? The moment of steam. So we return to the Industrial Revolution in the hope that it will divulge its reasons for welding growth to fossil fuels, the first of which was coal. But coal had been burnt in Britain for millennia. From the Bronze Age and the Roman occupation to the Middle Ages, fires of coal were appreciated for their intense heat, used, as we shall hear, in the kindling of religious ceremonies, the heating of homes, the cooking of food, and the processing of some materials, notably iron, in smithereries. Yet few would argue that the fossil economy emerged around the year 2000 BCE or 50 CE or in the 13th century. The union between self-sustaining growth and coal combustion existed at none of these times, because the former had yet to develop and the latter remained limited to heat generation. Britain had to wait for the Industrial Revolution to write out the growth formula and initiate a qualitative leap in the manner of coal consumption, the transformation of heat into motion, or the conversion of thermal into mechanical energy by means of the steam engine. In the first steam engines, coal was burnt in order to force a piston up and down in a vertical motion, well suited for the pumping of water, but not much else. Another form of motion was called for. In the words of a mid-19th century treatise, "Of all sorts of motion, that which is most frequently required in the arts is one of continued rotation. Mills in factories of every kind are impelled by machinery which receives its motion from a wheel." It was the earth-shattering exploit of James Watt to connect the coal fire to the wheel. With the device he patented in 1784, Watt finally adapted the motion of the piston to produce continuous circular motion, and thereby made his engine applicable to all purposes of manufacture, as stated by another tract. With this, the foundations of the fossil economy were laid down. What could the rotative steam engine accomplish that the hearth and pump of old could not? Most obviously, it could impel a machine. The prime fulcrum of self-sustaining growth, increasing output per capita, raising the productivity of labour in a universal speed-up that has yet to see its end. As a source of thermal energy, coal was useful for a range of processes requiring that input, but only as a source of mechanical, rotative, energy could it fuel the production of all sorts of commodities. Machinery is, explained the Rees Cyclopaedia, the most important compilation of technical knowledge in the early decades of the 19th century. The organs by which motion is altered in its velocity, its period and direction, and thus adapted to any purpose. Once coal had been made to power it, the fuel could flow into the veins of an economy throbbing with expansion. In this book, we shall study how the fossil fuel of coal was coupled to the machine through the rise of stationary steam power in the mills of Britain. A rotative engine could also impel a vehicle, the second fulcrum of self-sustaining growth, likewise receiving motion from wheels, travelling across sea and land, and transporting commodities, raw, finished, to and from the mills. A sequel to this study, entitled Fossil Empire, will deal with mobile steam power on a global scale. Heat could work on materials with certain chemical properties. Pumps could force up liquids. Machines and vehicles alone could fabricate and distribute the widest imaginable range of commodities, driving them with coal. The steam engine first made fossil fuels integral to growth across boundless expanses. Moreover, the combustion of coal in British cottages and smithereries never spurred other countries to adopt the fuel. Only the machine and the vehicle had the power to project the fossil economy out from the British Isles, through the pressures of economic competition and military invasion. A country flooded by commodities from steam-powered mills or attacked by the overwhelming force of steamboats would feel the whip of external necessity and, perhaps, seek to emulate the technology in order to save its industry or survive as a nation. As long as coal was primarily consumed within British households, distant communities had little reason to take notice. The existence of coal seams in Britain, or indeed on any continent in the world, was evidently not a sufficient condition for the transition. The same goes for the rotative steam engine. Like strata in the rock, that artifact could not, as a mute physical thing, spark off something like a fossil economy by itself. The mere presence of the engine, as certified in the legal rights of the inventor, tells us nothing about the extent to which it was actually installed, its function in the economy, or the propensity to emit carbon dioxide. The atmosphere does not feel the breath from a patent. History is stocked with inventions petrified into objects of exhibitions or fantasies in the style of Da Vinci, and so the question of the steam engine is the question of why it was adapted and diffused in Britain and, above all, in the cotton industry. There, it supplanted the water wheel. Before steam, the British cotton industry, the fast lane of the Industrial Revolution, in which self-sustaining growth first appeared, impelled its machines with water. So why did cotton capitalists turn from water to steam? By examining the causes of that original transition, we may come closer to an understanding of the mechanisms that launched, and perhaps still drive, the process now known as business as usual. Seeing power as power. The word power in the English language has a dual meaning. Power, as in a force of nature, a current of energy, a measure of work. Power, as in a relation between humans, an authority, a structure of domination. The conjunction is not as close in other major European languages. Motive power and absolute power are fuerza motriz and poder absoluto in Spanish. No apparent connection there, while French distinguishes between énergie and courant on the natural side of things, and puissance and pouvoir on the social, roughly equivalent to Kraft, Strom, and Macht, Gewalt in German. Hence, Atomkraft, but Weltmacht. Why have the two poles collapsed into one in English? An inquiry into such comparative European etymology is outside the scope of this study. We can only note the intriguing fact. Do the two meet in reality? In spite of the semantic confluence in the Anglophone world, thermodynamic and social power are nearly always treated as distinct phenomena, a habit encouraged by the disciplinary structure of academic research, as observed in one recent attempt to bridge the gap. Two authoritative works in the respective hemispheres exemplify the separation. In Energy in Nature and Society, General Energetics of Complex Systems, Václav Smil offers an exact definition of power as the rate of flow of energy, or W equals J over S, where J is joule, S is second, and W the unit of power. Watt from James. Put differently, power is here understood as the rate at which work is done or energy transformed, and that is all there is to it, apparently, for in spite of the nominally transdisciplinary character of his work, Smil does not so much as notice that there is another meaning to the term, much less any actual movement between the two. Turn to Stephen Luke's sociological classic, Power, A Radical View, and the other eye is shut. Here, the overlap between horsepower and power struggles is mentioned merely to indicate the terminological chaos surrounding power in society. The nature of social power can only be distilled if cleansed of all associations with the mechanical phenomenon, in a first, essential act of analytical distinction. In the dozens of dissections of the concept filling Luke's pages, there is no hint at power being at once energetic and interpersonal. Nor does he see any potential for plumbing the depths of social power by taking its mechanical base into account. The colloquial drift between the poles, reflexive, unnoticed, and perfectly realistic, has its counterpart in a stern intellectual segregation. The English language might contain a basic truth from which scientific research has become estranged. In any case, it permits us to formulate a general hypothesis guiding the rest of this work. The power derived from fossil fuels was dual in meaning and nature from the very start. Steam, as a form of superior power, was just that. The two moments cannot be isolated from each other, since they constituted each other in a unity, the opposites interpenetrating throughout. It is proven beyond all reasonable doubt that global warming does not have natural causes. Solar radiation, volcanic outgassing, endogenous variations in the carbon cycle, and other similar suspects have been decisively cleared of responsibility for the rise in temperatures, the root causes firmly passed to the social side of the equation. Once we cross that line, we immediately encounter power. Indeed, this happens as soon as we use the term fossil fuels. They are, by definition, a materialization of social relations. No piece of coal or drop of oil has yet turned itself into fuel, and no humans have yet engaged in systematic, large-scale extraction of either to satisfy subsistence needs. Fossil fuels necessitate waged or forced labour, the power of some to direct the labour of others, as conditions of their very existence. If we take the message of climate science seriously, we should direct our attention to power in the dual sense, first of all in the process of labour. That is the point of contact between humans and the rest of nature, where biophysical resources pass into the circuits of social metabolism, where coal and oil and gas are extracted, transported, coupled to machines, burnt. The process is peopled. As a primary agent of energy and matter transformation through the labour process, writes environmental historian Stefania Barker, workers are the primary interface between society and nature, wielding and subject to power. That is the sphere where the fossil economy must have originated. Neither environmental nor labour history has, for their own particular reasons, been very keen on connecting the dots of workers and the wider environment, class and climate. The same silence reigns in research on energy in the Industrial Revolution. Indeed, climate change as such remains primarily an object of natural science, recent spurts of interest in the social sciences notwithstanding. We are awash in data on the disastrous effects, but comparatively poor on insights into the drivers. Or, to paraphrase Marx, most climate science still dwells in the noiseless atmosphere, where everything takes place on the surface, rather than entering the hidden abode of production, where fossil fuels are actually produced and consumed. Natural scientists have so far interpreted global warming as a phenomenon in nature. The point, however, is to trace its human origins. Only thus can we retain at least a hypothetical possibility of changing course. Chapter 2. Scarcity, Progress, the Nature of the Human Species, Theories of the Rise of Steam. Steam as response to scarcity. Long before global warming crept up on modernity, a quick look sufficed to spot energy at the heart of the Industrial Revolution. In the rearview mirror of historians, among the most conspicuous facets were novel ways of harnessing the powers of nature for the purposes of production. The doyen of modern research on the role of energy in the Industrial Revolution is E.A. Wrigley. In a path-breaking article in 1962, he first broached ideas later developed into a grand narrative of the dynamics of change in 18th and 19th century Britain, and more generally, of economic growth. In what he would come to call the organic economy, all forms of material production are based on the land, raw materials, thermal energy, and motive force. Human and animal bodies used to put things in motion are drawn from the yield of present photosynthesis. That yield is restricted. There is no way to enlarge it beyond the constant supply of land. A growing organic economy will inevitably find itself trapped in fierce competition for scarce resources, making a permanent radical increase of industrial raw material supply a necessary condition for self-sustaining growth, very difficult to obtain. Dependency on the land imposes a tight bottleneck on industrial production. Fossil fuels shatter that bottleneck. Pre-industrial Britain was an archetypal organic economy, where the farmers fetched whatever they needed from the land: food, fodder for the animals, some sheared, some slaughtered, some employed as beasts of burden, furniture, building materials, originally even fuel for the fires. Everything came from the fields and the forests. The spinners and weavers, tanners and dyers, sawyers and carpenters, smiths and cabinet makers worked with fruits of one and the same earth, such as wool, flax, leather, hair, fur, straw, charcoal and, not the least important, wood itself. A growing sector could continue to grow only if it seized a larger slice of the pie from another. Within the tight energy budget of the organic economy, where all activities jostled for access to the same finite area of photosynthetic productivity, the process of growth could not possibly become universal or self-sustaining. Sooner rather than later, it would peter out. This idea Wrigley has borrowed, of course, from David Ricardo, to whom he gives ample credit. According to Ricardo, growth has to lay claim to more fertile land. As long as the economy is young and the country sparsely populated, this will present no problem. But at some point, land of an inferior quality will have to be called into cultivation. Wetlands, steep slopes, fields in the mountains, hitherto left untouched, are scoured for more soil on which to expand. More products now have to be wrested from increasingly meagre land with greater inputs of labour. Nature turns from a giver to a taker. In proportion as she becomes niggardly in her gifts, she exacts a greater price for her work. The prices of the foodstuffs extracted from her soil rise. Profits fall, accumulation sags, general descent into economic paralysis sets in, emanating from natural constraints. The stagnation will, Ricardo writes in a formulation repeatedly quoted by Wrigley, necessarily be rendered permanent by the laws of nature, which have limited the productive powers of the land. It is this chain of causation that Wrigley applies to the Industrial Revolution. It explains the turn to fossil fuels. The new system, designated the inorganic or mineral-based economy by Wrigley, finally broke the spell of stagnation. When iron, pottery, bricks, glass, salt, and other industries turned to coal, they bypassed the restricted surface area by digging into the stores of past photosynthesis. Wholly new vistas of expansion opening up beneath the forest and the field. Further down the same subterranean road, cars, ships, trains, planes, all sorts of consumer and capital goods would be made out of fossil fuels, thanks to which a perpetually growing economy could fly past Ricardian constraints. In Wrigley's scheme of things, such constraints explain not merely the preference for fossil fuels, but also, and perhaps more importantly, the very conditions of self-sustaining growth. Only when British capitalists removed the stones from the tombs of coal could expansion be called out to live eternally. One method used by Wrigley and his followers to illustrate the logic is to convert coal into acres of land required to generate the same amount of energy. In 1750, all coal produced in England would have equaled 4.3 million acres of woodland, or 13% of the national territory. In 1800, substituting wood for all coal would have demanded 112 million acres, or 35% of the British land surface. By 1850, the figures had risen to 48.1 million acres and 150%, respectively. As early as in 1750, then, a hypothetical total conversion from coal to wood in the British economy would have represented a significant proportion of the land surface for which there were many other competing uses. In 1800, it would have been quite impractical. In 1850, the threshold of 100% crossed, self-evidently an impossibility. In other words, in the absence of coal as an energy source, Ricardian pressures would have become acute. Forests denuded, soils exhausted, growth grinding to a halt. In a similar computation inspired by Wrigley, Rolf Peter Ziefeler concludes that already by the 1820s, coal had freed an area equivalent to the total surface of Britain, while Paolo Melanima, likewise standing on the shoulders of Wrigley, estimates that, in the absence of fossil fuels, Europe would have needed a land area more than 2.7 times its entire continental surface in 1900, rising to more than 20 times in 2000. But the pressures undone by coal were not only Ricardian in character. They arose from reproduction as much as from production. According to Wrigley, Malthus's theorem of geometrically growing population and arithmetically growing food supplies, generating a tendency for output per head to fall, was indeed valid in an organic economy. The arguments of the old parson, plants struggle for room within the constricted bounds of the planet, all animals have a constant tendency to increase beyond the means of subsistence. Surplus populations, unable to find food, will be sired. Are incontrovertible as long as fossil fuels have not been hauled into the economy. Before that point, population growth will necessarily cause a decline in living standards, since more people have to divide the same fixed supply of land into smaller pieces. After that point, pressure on the land will be dramatically alleviated. Coal will allow for the population to increase by leaps and bounds. Here was another cause of its usage. The Malthusian component of the argument has, however, received its most articulate expression in a study by Richard G. Wilkinson, nowadays better known for his work on the unhealthy impacts of social inequality, in books such as The Spirit Level. In Poverty and Progress, an ecological model of economic development, Wilkinson seeks to construct, as the title suggests, a most general model of development derived from the case of the British Industrial Revolution. People do not invent new technologies because they are affluent, but because, and only when, they are poor. Poverty is a symptom of resource scarcity. Such a condition comes about when a human population succumbs to its innate tendency, common to every animal population, to reproduce beyond the bounds of its resource base. The early deductions in Malthus's essay, transcribed virtually verbatim, plus a dose of Darwin. Normally, humans try to uphold a precarious ecological equilibrium and cut their coat according to their cloth by means of cultural norms, including everything from infanticide to taboos on profligate sexual intercourse. For some reason, however, that equilibrium might break down, and it is then that things begin to move. A society that fails to curb its appetite for procreation because of a disturbance to some part of the cultural system plunges into want. It has no choice but to innovate. Swelling numbers being impossible to sustain within the given niche, scarcity forces the society to make some alteration in the way it gains its living from the environment. Exactly what happened on the eve of the Industrial Revolution in the late 17th century. English couples lost their self-restraint and fertility spiked. The growing population resorted at first to the available slack in the resource base, but by the 18th century, the breakdown had reached abysmal levels, obliging England to embark on the substitution of mineral resources for land-based ones. Coal resolved a crisis of overpopulation. Like all innovations that composed the Industrial Revolution, the exploitation of fossil fuels was the outcome of a valiant struggle of a society with its back to the ecological wall, a response to a particular resource shortage, a decision made under duress. Ricardo and Malthus, then, are the fathers of this way of thinking about energy in the Industrial Revolution. The great irony, according to Wrigley, is that both made their pronouncements on the impossibility of self-sustaining growth at the very moment when the obstacles to such growth were removed. Yet they bequeathed the proper tools for understanding the transition. In that precious box may also be found the insights of Adam Smith, as argued by Kenneth Pomerantz in The Great Divergence, China, Europe, and the Making of the Modern World Economy, a work that set much of the agenda for economic history in the 21st century. Pomerantz contends that England and China, or rather the Yangtze Delta, essentially followed the same trajectories all the way up to the 19th century. Both exhibited high population densities, specialisation, Smithian division of labour, a gradually heightened propensity to truck, barter and exchange, economic growth, in short. Both likewise achieved rising agricultural productivity, relatively free markets for land and labour, improved standards of living, and both were running headlong towards ecological crash. The land constraint was just about to pull them down when England realised the full potentials of its coal reserves. Pomerantz's explanation for the great 19th century divergence between England and the Yangtze Delta has two prongs: colonies and coal, to which England alone had access. No specific constellation of social relations and technologies set the West on its exceptional path. Rather, institutions and basic mechanical proficiencies were, to all intents and purposes, identical in the Far East. But coal from the Chinese inland had to be transported over prohibitive distances to the coast, while English manufacturers had coal mines, if not under their feet, then within the easy reach of their ships. China failed to ferry fossil fuels to its literal hothouses of Smithian growth, stayed within the limits of finite land, and began to regress. England became a world leader. Anchored in nearby mineral endowments and distant dominions with scant purchase on the strictly energetic side of the process, Western Europe, England at its core, became a fortunate freak, breaking through the fundamental constraints of energy use and resource availability that had previously limited everyone's horizons. With this interpretation of the divergence, Pomerantz, in effect, elevates the triple drivers of division of labour, trade and population growth. Smith, Ricardo, Malthus, into global vectors, equally present in 18th century China and England, equally threatened by the universal land constraint. The lucky islanders alone could then excavate a track to exponential growth. The endorsement of the school of thought pioneered by Wrigley has taken the form of a near consensus, culminating in his magnum opus, Energy and the English Industrial Revolution from 2010. It now deserves the epithet of a paradigm, most normal research on the topic following its lodestar. Since the land constraint of Ricardo is dominant within it, the procreating populations of Malthus secondary and Smith a relatively peripheral figure, we shall call it the Ricardian-Malthusian paradigm. Astrid Kander and her colleagues sum up its cardinal thesis in their Power to the People, Energy in Europe over the Last 5 Centuries, a study dressing up Wrigley's account with more numbers. The start of the energy transition was brought about by the need to replace natural resources that were becoming scarce in the face of rising demand. A liberation, a breakout, an escape, the switch to fossil energy is here caused by scarcities, while pointing to the future as the opening act of self-sustaining growth, in what might seem, at first glance, a coherent and compelling analysis. How, then, does the Ricardian-Malthusian paradigm account for the rise of steam power? Wrigley, for one, singles it out as the decisive departure from the organic economy. As long as it was burnt for heat, coal remained of limited value, relief from the curses of Ricardo and Malthus a doubtful prospect. But once the fuel had become a source of mechanical power, the way was clear for individual productivity to make a quantum leap. The tortoise could now sprint rather than crawl. Production could outpace population. Mechanical, not thermal, power shattered the bottleneck, and it did so only in the second quarter of the 19th century when, as Wrigley notices, the steam engine became the dominant prime mover in some manufacturing. First to be let out of confinement was the cotton industry. It housed more engines than any other sector of the British economy up to perhaps 1870, through a period when the very same engines were the most important single consumer of coal. A thermodynamic Ricardian, Wrigley builds his model on the limitations of present photosynthesis. Plants capture a fraction of the incoming solar radiation and convert it into organic matter on the land, which is restricted, leaving only a narrow energy base on which humans can draw. The organic economy of pre-industrial Britain was characterised by its complete dependence on plants, directly wood as fuel, or indirectly fodder for beasts of burden and so on. This is where Ricardo's theorems come into effect. A rising demand for energy could only be met from the products of plant photosynthesis. It therefore necessarily meant increased pressure on the land. And this spelt trouble in the long run. Now, if the adoption of steam power in manufacturing constituted the critical step out of the bounds of the organic economy and into continuous growth, and if the virtue of coal was to detach energy needs from present photosynthesis, then the prime movers, replaced by steam, must, for Wrigley's model to hold, have been fueled by plants, wood-burning stoves or food-burning mussels. But that was precisely not the case. Water was the element on which Britain's industries, cotton foremost among them, surfed before they turned to steam. Watt's engine, vanquished the water wheel, but obviously not because of the inherent limitations of present photosynthesis. Water is no plant, nor does it have to eat one to flow. To identify a Ricardian exigency in the transition from water to steam, Wrigley has to uproot the notion of scarcity from the soil and broaden it to encompass any kind of shortage, such as that of, in this case, waterfalls. In his original 1962 piece, he notes the delay between Watt's invention in the 1780s and the adoption of steam in the cotton industry in the second quarter of the 19th century, contending that only after a generation of expansion had caused the need for power to outstrip the capabilities of the human arm and the water wheel was the steam engine brought into use. In this version of events, the wheels were discarded because they could not deliver the requisite quantities of energy, their fuel being in too short supply. Unused waterfalls with a sufficient head had become few and remote, roughly corresponding to the Ricardian law of diminishing returns, presumably realised through a rise in the price of water relative to steam. Wilkinson settles for the same story. The use of water power was limited by the number of streams with suitable sites for mills. New sites became scarce in many parts of the country during the 17th century, whereas coal to fuel the steam engine was plentiful, especially at the pit head. The spread of steam power was ecologically favoured, but, he goes on to assert, jumping between the centuries, it was not until the late 18th century, when the new cotton mills began to add to the demand for rotary power and good mill sites were no longer available, that Boulton and Watt invented steam and delivered manufacturers from the acute shortage. Equally aware of the implications of the steam breakthrough, Pomerantz alleges that water power, no matter how much the wheels were improved, simply did not have the same potential to provide energy inputs that would significantly outpace a rapidly growing population. Kander and her fellow pupils of Wrigley, who copy his view of the steam engine as the true quantum leap, affirm that water could not keep up with population growth and so had to be abandoned. An ecological niche bursting at the seams, a dearth of water blocking further growth. Here is the Ricardian-Malthusian account of the rise of steam power. We shall see how it fits with the historical record. Steam as human fire. On the 9th of May 2013, the daily average concentration of carbon dioxide in the air, as measured high on the slopes of a Hawaiian volcano, at the Mauna Loa Observatory, the oldest station for monitoring CO2 in the world, and the global benchmark site for tracking the rise and rise of the gas, first crept above 400 parts per million, ppm. The milestone elicited few banner headlines. To the scientific community and those members of the public who were concerned, it was yet another reminder of the disturbing fact that the composition of the atmosphere is flying out of bounds at record speed. The last time the concentration of CO2 hovered around 400 ppm was at least 2.5 million years ago, during the epoch of the Pliocene. It is believed to have stayed below 500 ppm since the onset of the Miocene, around 24 million years back in deep history. During the Holocene, the epoch beginning when the last ice age ended, nearly 12,000 years ago, it has fluctuated between 260 and 285 ppm, like a ball gently rolling between narrow rails, the boundaries within which sedentary civilization developed. In the past millennium, the variations were no larger than 5 ppm, until the Industrial Revolution threw the gas into another orbit. Presently, the concentration rises by 2 ppm every year. Given that carbon dioxide acts as a thermostat in regulating the temperature on Earth, and given that the temperature sets the climatic conditions in which all life on Earth exists, the magnitude of the rise, from 285 ppm as late as the mid-19th century to the current 400+, upgrades Homo sapiens into a geological agent. She now tinkers with some of the most fundamental variables of the Earth system. The markers of epochs are altered. In the vast geological, Pliocene, Miocene, Holocene, not the mundane historical, Sasani, Fatimid, Victorian sense, historical time catching up with and penetrating geological time. The Holocene has come to an end, or so argue a growing chorus of geologists, chemists, environmental historians, sustainability scientists, and others, who champion the idea that a new epoch has dawned on the planet, the Anthropocene. The term suggests that the Earth has now left its natural geological epoch, the present interglacial state called the Holocene. Human activities have become so pervasive and profound that they rival the great forces of nature and are pushing the Earth into planetary terra incognita. The claim is not, of course, that humans never left any imprint on their environments in earlier times, but rather that a qualitative scale-up has occurred. Even such events as the extinction of the Pleistocene megafauna or the deforestation of Mediterranean hills failed to touch all ecosystems, reach into all niches of terrestrial and aquatic life, or modulate the state of the planet as a whole at once. Precisely what the overaccumulation of heat within the biosphere through the rise in CO2 is now accomplishing. Global warming, however, is only one of the truly epochal changes wrought by humans, as theorists of the Anthropocene are keen to stress. Besides carbon, several cycles of elements essential to life, notably nitrogen, phosphorus, and sulfur, are now out of joint due to human overextraction and overemission. The water cycle has been upset by the damming of rivers and the clearing of land. The sixth major event of species extinction is underway. Oceans are acidifying, ozone is depleted, and the list goes on. Signs of planet-wide human ascendancy seem to crisscross all spheres of life. Yet the proponents of the Anthropocene concept tend to give global warming and the rise of its main chemical agent pride of place as crucial evidence of a new age. We propose that atmospheric CO2 concentration can be used as a single, simple indicator to track the progression of the Anthropocene, write Will Steffen and colleagues, and the proposition is sound. No other perturbation of the biosphere can rival the destructive potential of this one. A question then imposes itself. When did it all begin? The breakthrough of the neologism dates to atmospheric chemist and Nobel laureate Paul Crutzen's short piece, The Geology of Mankind, in Nature in 2002, beginning with the observation that global climate may depart from natural behaviour for many millennia to come, followed by a striking announcement. The Anthropocene could be said to have started in the latter part of the 18th century, when analyses of air trapped in polar ice showed the beginning of growing global concentrations of carbon dioxide and methane. This date also happens to coincide with James Watt's design of the steam engine in 1784. The chronology went viral. In the burgeoning literature on the Anthropocene, the birth of the epoch is frequently, if not habitually, associated with Watt's invention of the rotative steam engine as the one artifact that catapulted the human species to full-spectrum dominance of the planet. Among the cited precursors to the concept is Henry Bergson, who peered far into the future in his L'Evolution Créatrice from 1907. A century has elapsed since the invention of the steam engine, and we are only just beginning to feel the depths of the shock it gave us. In thousands of years, when, seen from a distance, only the broad lines of the present age will still be visible, our wars and our revolutions will count for little, even supposing they are remembered at all. But the steam engine, and the procession of inventions of every kind that accompanied it, will perhaps be spoken of as we speak of the bronze or of the chipped stone of prehistoric times. It will serve to define an age. Or perhaps the end of all ages. In Hyperobjects, Philosophy and Ecology After the End of the World, celebrated eco-critic Timothy Morton outlined a bold new worldview appropriate to the Anthropocene in general and global warming in particular, and he knows more than most. The end of the world has already occurred. We can be uncannily precise about the date on which the world ended, Morton writes, giving the event a rather odd interpretation and a very exact date. It was April 1784, when James Watt patented the steam engine, an act that commenced the depositing of carbon in Earth's crust. namely the inception of humanity as a geophysical force on a planetary scale. So the world no longer exists, thanks to Watt's patent. Such hyperbole aside, the adduced reasons for appointing the steam engine as the executioner of epochs are not always very convincing. The small rise in the concentration of CO2 that can be detected in polar ice from the late 18th century remained well within the natural variability of the Holocene. It cannot possibly have been caused by a simultaneously issued patent. By that time, the emissions from deforestation were still larger than those from fossil fuels. The rationale for placing the coming of steam on par with an asteroid impact, or the end of a glacial period, must be qualitative, along the lines sketched above. Steam heralded a new union between growth and fossil fuels, or the energy society feedback loop went into overdrive. In the words of climate bestseller The Burning Question, none of this can be a matter of invention. A patent is but a piece of paper, however symbolic. Not Watt, but manufacturers who chose to adopt his engine, issued in business as usual. What, then, do theorists of the Anthropocene have to say about the actual causes of the rise of steam? Not much, but they do propound a general framework for understanding the historical causality behind the transition to fossil fuels, which, for reasons of logical necessity, they deduce from human nature. If the dynamics were of a more contingent character, the narrative of an entire species, the Anthropos, as such, ascending to biospheric supremacy, would be difficult to uphold. The geology of mankind must have its roots in the properties of that being. Anything less would make it a geology of some smaller entity, perhaps some subset of Homo sapiens. The answer to the historical questions is therefore a story told around a classical element. Fire. The human species alone can manipulate fire. In Carbon and the Anthropocene, prominent climate scientists Michael R. Raupach and Jossip G. Cannadel observe that life on Earth has created vast stores of detrital carbon, the remnants of carbon-based organisms after they have died. Fossil fuels fall into this basic category, as do dead vegetation and the bodies of killed animals. Now, around 500,000 years ago, the ancestors of humankind began systematically to burn such detrital carbon as they learned to master the element of fire, igniting, spreading, and putting it out at will. This unique capability accorded advantages to the human lineage, allowing it to tap into exosomatic energy like no other creature on Earth. Here was the essential evolutionary trigger for the Anthropocene. It drove humanity straight to the discovery that energy could be derived not only from detrital biotic carbon, but also from detrital fossil carbon, at first from coal. This much more concentrated energy source catalyzed developments in technology, which led eventually to the technological explosion of the industrial era and thence to the Anthropocene as usually defined. In the Anthropocene, the human species has come to dominate the planet. Exosomatic energy was, and still is, an essential catalyst for this development, and the primary reason for its availability is that, long before the industrial era, a particular primate species learned how to tap the energy reserves stored in detrital carbon. It is worth pausing to consider what is being said here. It is not that the Anthropocene began long before the Industrial Revolution. Raupach and Cannadel stick to the crux and chronology. Rather, they claim that the essential catalyst and primary reason for the large-scale combustion of fossil fuels as it spread in the industrial era are, in fact, the mastering of fire by a particular primate species some 500,000 years ago. My learning to walk at the age of one is the reason for me dancing salsa today. The same with humanity burning first a tree and then, 500,000 years later, a barrel of oil. Indeed, in the eyes of Raupach and Cannadel, the line runs straight from the original mastery of fire to the surge in CO2 emissions from China in the early 21st century. The very existence of detrital fossil carbon, combined with humanity's primordial knowledge of how to burn the biotic variant, led to the technological explosion of the industrial era, from which the rest followed as a matter of course. Whatever we may think of the substance of these claims, it is important to note again that their logical structure is indispensable for the maintenance of the Anthropocene narrative. Some universal trait of the species must have blazed the trail to the geological epoch that is its own. For literary theorist Karen Pinkus, the present is indistinguishable from the very distant past. Not much new has happened for nearly a million years. The present, the one now called the Anthropocene, begins around 992,000 years ago, as Homo erectus rises and sets a fire alight, a first step leading straight to the second, in the 16th century, when British wood becomes scarce and coal is adopted as a fuel, followed by the conclusive invention of 1784. Geographer Nigel Clark goes even further. He avers that climate change is primarily the result of an escalating human capacity for combustion, traced back to Homo erectus's handling of fire on the African savanna 1.6 million years ago. Standard Anthropocene talk. But then he proceeds to ask, what kind of planet is this that births a creature capable of doing such things? The pyromaniac inclination inheres in the Earth itself. A store of fireworks circulating around the Sun, the planet possesses an atmosphere rich in oxygen, flammable fuels and plenty of materials for ignition. As long as the Earth has existed, its surface has been burning. Wherever there is vegetation, a wildfire sooner or later breaks out. Humans have done nothing more than articulate this geological DNA, augmenting the planet's own pyrophytic tendencies, accelerating a combustive imperative that defines the Earth itself, of which the recent propensity to tap into sedimented and fossilized biomass is the latest. Here, the concept of the Anthropocene is pressed towards its outer limits. Human agency is now the medium through which the planet realizes its latent destructivity. The combustion of coal and oil, a sort of telluric ventriloquism or delegated pyromania. In Clark, the Earth, qua celestial body, is the active incendiary. It has invested in fire, wagered on fire. It has been perverse enough to produce a fire creature known as man. On this view, the ultimate cause of climate change in the Anthropocene, implemented through the steam engine and all the other technologies, is not a distant event in the evolution of the human species, but the genesis of planet Earth itself some 4 billion years ago, from whose combustible rocks an arsonist sun has arisen. But Clark is on the fringe of Anthropocene theory. It is more common to draw the line of causation back to early human evolution, but no further. To ruminate over the late fossil feats of the fire ape, Homo pyrophilus, as in former environmental activist Mark Linus's popularisation of Anthropocene thinking, aptly titled The God Species, How the Planet Can Survive the Age of Humans. At other times, familiar Malthusian themes are mobilised to explain the turn to fossil fuels. The original contribution and telltale trope of Anthropocene theory, or perhaps we shall lend it the more humble status of a narrative, is neither fire nor scarcity, however, but precisely the belief in the human species as the source of steam power. Fossil fuel combustion, climate change, and related biospheric afflictions. There is constant talk of something called the human enterprise as the force now colliding with the rest of nature. What exactly this enterprise consists of is never specified, but we are led to understand that it represents a species on the move, acting out predispositions present since the early days of the hominids. Debate continues to rage over the details of the Anthropocene. Some advocate a far earlier date of birth for the epoch, but the Industrial Revolution still enjoys near consensus. Since 2008, and with another few years of negotiations expected before a verdict, the Stratigraphy Commission of the Geological Society of London is considering the formal announcement of Anthropocene as the current epoch. A few dissidents allege that the concept belongs to pop culture, rather than rigorous stratigraphic practice. And indeed, it has undergone a most spectacular career since Crutzen's 2002 paper, spreading far beyond the Ivory Tower, embraced by everyone, from the economist to Marxist scholars. Whether or not the Anthropocene is officially declared successor to the Holocene, it has already suffused discourses around global warming and other facets of environmental change. If only by virtue of this influence, it has become a reality to reckon with. At a closer look, it may also be a part of the problem. Steam as superior machine. The handmill gives you society with the feudal lord, the steam mill society with the industrial capitalist. Thus runs what is undoubtedly the most famous statement by Karl Marx featuring steam. It appears in The Poverty of Philosophy, Marx's assault on the ideas of Pierre-Joseph Proudhon, in the context of an attempt to explain not the rise of steam power, but social change in general and the development of capitalist relations of production in particular. In his maxim, Marx spells out an unequivocal and, within the wider Marxist tradition, highly influential hypothesis on the arrow of causation in an industrialising economy such as Britain's. Steam begets capital, not the other way around. More precisely, steam engenders the division and organisation of labour we recognise as typically capitalist. Labour is organised, is divided differently according to the instruments it disposes over. The handmill presupposes a different division of labour from the steam mill. Some script enclosed within the technology of steam power dictates a certain caste of capitalists and workers, foremen and assistants, and other roles to be occupied inside the factory and spilling out into society at large. Reversing the terms, putting relations before machinery in the causal sequence, would be tantamount to slapping history in the face. In The Poverty, no doubt is left on the determining instance or direction of progress. In acquiring new productive forces, men change their mode of production. And in changing their mode of production, in changing the way of earning their living, they change all their social relations. It is this historical law that is illustrated by the hand mill, steam mill aphorism. Steam chosen as the emblematic productive force, moulding society in its own image. This version of the Marxist theory of history, there are others certainly to be inspected later, is sometimes referred to as productive force determinism. It received its classical exposition in G. A. Cohen's Karl Marx's Theory of History, A Defence, where the analytical philosopher grapples with two questions left suspended by Marx and Engels. First, what is it that makes technology develop on its own? Second, how is it that this development comes to determine that of society? Or, in Marxist terminology, what is the motor driving the productive forces forward in history, and via what transmission system do they govern the relations of production? Cohen answers by drawing a picture of man as placed in a hostile environment, a crude, unforgiving nature that never caters to his needs. The situation of humanity is one of material scarcity. To better his lot, man must engage in labour and, more precisely, activate his two unique faculties of intelligence and rationality. He will be intelligent enough to invent a spade that allows him to dig into the crust in shorter time and with less effort than before, and if his brother has the choice to pick up that newly invented spade, he will be rational enough to do it. Scarcity provides the abiding incentive to invention. Intelligence fashions smart solutions. Rationality ensures their adoption. Ever looking for novel ways to prevail against nature, men perpetually boost their productive forces, and this growth of human power is the central process of history. The need for that growth explains why there is history. Along the way, knowledge arises. The development of the productive forces is very largely the growth in knowledge of how to control and transform nature, Cohen writes, going on to quote Marx. The handmill gives you society with the feudal lord. The steam mill, society with the industrial capitalist. A steam-powered generation of the capitalist which, at bottom, results from advancing knowledge. The raison d'etre of the engine is its technological superiority. It gives men new abilities to combat shortage, be more efficient, extract resources from nature at a higher rate. Steam is there because it represents progress. Indeed, knowledge of the engine is a sufficient condition for its deployment. To suggest otherwise would be to offend human rationality. Given how humans are constituted, intelligent and rational, they will avail themselves of any known technology that facilitates their struggle against parsimonious nature. The productive forces are knowledge made concrete, and as such they will prevail. But how would something like a steam engine come to arrange the internal affairs of men? Befitting a philosopher, Cohen answers with a thought experiment centred on a device for producing mechanical energy, a treadmill. Although he chooses neither a handmill nor a steam mill, he likely has the aphorism in mind when constructing his story. Indeed, it can be read as an explication of what Marx meant to say. Imagine, Cohen begins, a productively weak society whose members live in equality at subsistence level and who wish they were better off. This is the original situation of scarcity. Now, one of them suspects that the introduction of treadmills on the bank of the river on which they rely for irrigation would increase the flow of water onto the land, raise its yield, and thus enhance their welfare. This is the moment of human intelligence. He puts his idea to the community, who are impressed, and a group is forthwith commissioned to design and construct the devices. This is the hour of rationality, and apparently of community-wide decision-making, a sort of democratic deliberation over whether or not to introduce the invention. Then the treadmills are installed at suitable points on the riverbank and tested, all members of the community participating in the test. Wise as they are, they correctly appreciate the benefits of the machines, and a call goes out for volunteers to man them. But now the troubles begin. No one steps forward. Treading is odious work. Everyone detests the mere thought of it. Instead, it is agreed to select unfortunate drudges by lot. But soon it becomes apparent that the rebarbative job will not be executed without supervision. From this moment, laid down by the technological requirements of the treadmill, gradually a class structure, supervisors, farmers, treaders, rises in what was an egalitarian community. The history of class relations has dawned. So, by dint of their physical constitution inserted into the lives of men, the productive forces bring forth new relations of production, intervening in society and selecting the organisation they need to develop fully. How would this theory apply to the steam engine? Cohen does not investigate it. He investigates no actual cases, but it is fairly obvious how a basic storyline in compliance with his laws would read. Before the engine, men were afflicted by a scarcity of energy. One man was intelligent enough to invent it. Being rational, his fellow members of the community immediately saw the value of the knowledge, losing no time in the struggle against scarcity. The steam engine was promptly installed. Because of the technical requirements of the apparatus, the roles were opened for the industrial capitalist, the overlooker and the factory operative to own, supervise and serve the engine, output steadily on the rise. And such is indeed the storyline that has dominated much of the historiography of the Industrial Revolution, and the rise of steam power in particular. Outside of Marxism, in the bourgeois mainstream, it is better known as technological determinism, or simply, technicism. In Capital and Steam Power, 1750-1800, written in the mid-1960s, John Lord depicts the ascent of steam as the climbing of a scientific ladder leading from primitive prototypes in the mines to consummated designs in the mills. By inventing the rotative engine, Watt completed the breach between employer and employed. They were separated completely. A capitalist class had been evolved, and admission to its ranks could only be obtained by accident. The progress of apprentice to master was the exception instead of the rule, and the line of cleavage that has troubled the world ever since had been drawn. The Marxist version belongs to a wider crop of technological determinism, with two distinctive beliefs. First, some superiority intrinsic to the very makeup of novel technologies ensures their diffusion. Second, that same markup brings forth a corresponding set of social roles. Applied to the rise of steam, the rotative engine would have outmatched alternative prime movers due to better performance, higher efficiency, or some similar technical property, much as Cohen's treadmill raised the yield, and then summoned capitalists and workers to enter their special relationship. The theory is fully compatible, and indeed overlaps with the Ricardian-Malthusian paradigm and the Anthropocene narrative. All advance some doctrine of a human enterprise. The question of steam may serve as a litmus test for all three. How might it be conducted? The Ricardian-Malthusian paradigm and productive force determinism both result in fairly straightforward hypotheses on the causes of the rise of steam. If it turned out that the transition occurred despite the energy of the alternative prime mover remaining abundant and cheaper, if it exhibited neither scarcity nor a rise in the relative price, then the Ricardian-Malthusian hypothesis would hang by a thread. If the productive force contending with the steam engine retained considerable potential for technological prowess unrealized at the time of the transition, or if steam triumphed even without a distinct edge in neutral, instrumental terms of performance or efficiency, the hypothesis of productive force and technological determinism would be in trouble. It would suffer an even harder blow if the relations of production, particularly those between capital and labour, enforced the selection of steam power and not vice versa. The causal claims of the Anthropocene narrative, on the other hand, are of a more conceptual, philosophical, perhaps even metaphysical nature. We shall reflect upon them as such later. But if some humans introduced steam power against the explicit resistance of other humans, then it would be hard to maintain a notion of it as the expression of a species-wide project. The data will have to decide the matter. If they contradict the three theoretical frameworks, we would need to construct another explanation for the rise of steam, and, more broadly, another theory of the fossil economy. A point of departure might then be the hypothesis, if supported by the data, that steam arose as a form of power exercised by some people against others. Chapter 3. The Long Life of the Flow. Industrial Energy Before Coal. Flow, animate power, stock. The term prime mover has a strangely dual import. In any dictionary or encyclopedia, two definitions rub elbows. There is, first, the metaphysical prime mover, the original and unmoved impulse, the self-caused agent that is the cause of all things, God being the common referent, or, otherwise put, the self-moved being that is the source of all motion. This phenomenon is distinguished precisely by not requiring any external input. God runs on no fuel. But then, secondly, there is the mechanical prime mover, which, according to Webster's 1989 edition, is also an initial agent, but of a very different kind. It is a machine, as a water wheel or steam engine, which receives and modifies energy as supplied by some natural source. In this more earthly sense, the prime mover is anything but self-moved. Rather, it is utterly dependent on some natural source, a fuel, without which it will set neither itself nor any other entity in motion. In early 19th century Britain, the term had descended from the skies and conclusively taken on its second meaning in mills and workshops across the kingdom. In his Treatise on the Steam Engine from 1827, John Fahey noticed the inversion of the metaphysical definition. Here it should be remarked that the first mover does not actually produce the force with which it operates, but is adapted to collect and concentrate the force which arises from some natural cause, so as to derive the motion from that cause. The first act of the manufacturer, the mechanic or the millwright, was to locate and appropriate a suitable force already existing in nature, the task of the prime mover being merely to harvest that force and pass it on to other bodies. A range of prime movers existed from which to choose. The main options were windmills, water wheels, horse gins, human beings, and steam engines, all falling under the prosaic definition. A prime mover is a mechanism for generating mechanical power out of an energy source and putting other mechanisms in motion. We may thus group the prime movers into categories according to their sources of energy. Under what rubrics? The terms carbon neutral and carbon intensive point to properties of energy sources that are of great interest to us, and probably even more to future generations, but not to the manufacturers of the time. Writers of the early 19th century were indeed aware of the high carbon content of coal, but this was not a factor in decisions on what source to use. The same goes for the dichotomy renewable versus non-renewable. Other couplets fail on different counts. As we have heard, E.A. Wrigley has proposed a distinction between an organic economy based on the products of photosynthesis and an inorganic one dependent on fossil fuels. But the terms are unfortunate. No matter how long it has been underground, coal is a substance of organic nature, which is why its combustion releases carbon. Wind and water are not. A manufacturer turning from a water wheel to a steam engine.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.